well, but you know, I don't do these things except on these things like 10-year anniversaries. I've got to go to India, they tell me, in the future, and I'm really excited about that. Oh, hallelujah. Just ready to go, boy. Let me tell you how it was. This was no vacation. I'll tell this again Sunday, so don't let it bore you. We took a road in a four-wheel drive vehicle, and it took us 10 hours to go 100 miles. 10 hours to go 100 miles in a four-wheel vehicle. And I promise you, and there was times we got out, and it was torrential rain, and we'd get out and stand. I'd have an umbrella standing out on the side, one-lane roads, and you'd have to push other cars up the road. This was no pleasure trip for Lawrence, I promise you. But them missionaries convinced me they need vehicles. And I think that's why they did it. Me and Paul Poe went with me, and Dick Babinoff from our church, they were convinced that these people were convincing us that they need new vehicles. I said, are you trying to tell us that you want us to help you raise money to get vehicles? Buddy, you didn't have to do it this way, I promise you. But it worked, amen. But it was an interesting trip. And I guess the greatest thing that happened was that night at Molo, we're dedicating that church, and I was speaking, the power of God fell on these people. And literally, you remember the nights we have Holy Spirit nights? People pinned to the floor? Hundreds of them, stacked like cordwood. My friend Ron Hammond was catching them, and he was falling down with them. They were falling on top of him because the two or three would fall at once. He would try to catch all three of them. They'd all fall together. Hallelujah. It was wonderful. It was wonderful. And what got me the most, after going to the Maasai tribe to look and see these 6'6", 6'7" warriors standing there at the altars, and their ears, you know, I knew who they were. There's no denying who they are. Trust me. You know who they are after you've seen one. You will recognize them. They have a certain look about them. They are serious men. Hey, think about it. These people say, lion, make my day. And all they're carrying is a little stick. And they mean it. I'm serious. They walk out there with the lions and they carrying a stick. And I said, what do? They said, they beat those lions with those sticks. Little 12-year-old boys are out there doing it. I said, this is crazy. But there they were, and I laid my hand on one. This guy, he was about 6'7". He's looking at me, just, man, it's scary looking. One eye was blind, and one eye could see. And this one, it's covered over with a white, ashy look, mean looking. I laid my hand on him, and wham! I said, "Oh, thank you, God! Thank you, Lord! Hallelujah!" You know, bam! I said, "Oh, thank you, Jesus." Thank you for doing that. I loved them, though. I fell in love. Well, anyway, I was going to tell you is that I got an invitation from Washington Getty to come back and have supper with the president in Nairobi, Kenya, in the future. And I'm going to go back and sit down with the president of the country, and we're going to have supper together. And it's going to help. Washington Getty is kind of an interesting guy. Reason I didn't realize that he had this much influence. I want to get him to help all the other missionaries in Kenya because he has to pay no taxes. Anything he brings into the country is tax-free. The president just says, nothing on Washington Getty. It's his best friend. They pay 40% tax. If you import something in, import tax. But Washington doesn't. It's all by, it just, anything comes in his crate under his name. And so when we get a vehicle or something, these other guys have been paying all this money. Isn't it nice that Washington, I took a little pin off my jacket one time and stuck it on his tie, hugged his neck, and he never forgot. And presented 720 churches to me, and I didn't even know they were there. It happened in 1988. You never know what you're doing today that might affect you 10 years later. You never know. Well, that's some of it. I can't tell it all, or we won't get to the business meeting tonight, and that's what's scheduled. I've been up 24 hours flying, 20 hours in the air, and 4 hours in London. And all the other guys were with me. I told them, I said, if you're a real man, you'll be at church. No, they're not here. Proverbs 11, verse 24. There is one who scatters yet increases more, and there is one who withholds more that is right, and it leads to poverty. The generous soul, verse 25, will be made rich, and he who waters will also be watered himself. I want you to understand what we're talking about here. We're talking about why God prospers us. He gives seed to the sower to sow more seed. And after what I saw, we need all the money we can ever raise in this church. For someday, this church is going to give $1 million a year in world missions. Someday, I'm going to send missionaries out from this church when we get financially strong enough, and they'll be all over the world, and we'll be supporting them. We'll have flags hanging around here, and they'll be our people. That's my vision. That's why I want to get out of debt. You understand? But the reason God will prosper us greatly, is that we understand these principles, that we scatter, yet it comes back to us. If we withhold, it lends to poverty. We know we can get rich. Our soul is generous, soul will be made rich. And if water, will be watered ourselves. In verse 30, the fruits of righteousness is a tree of life. And he who wins souls is wise. He who wins souls is wise. And this is the reason God will cause us always to prosper as a local church, is that we understand that we sow seeds so that souls will be saved. He died for all mankind here in Jerusalem, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the earth. And we are debtors to help those who are not as fortunate as we, so they may hear the gospel. Folks, there are still places, trust me, that don't have satellite to pick up television. I saw 2 televisions when I was in Kenya. 2. And they were both in the television rooms of the hotels. No hotel room had a television in it that I was in. It's going to take people with getting in their Jeeps, their four-wheel vehicles, and going back, way back, with risk of life, to tell them about Jesus. So that's why I challenge you to give, so that we can be strong in Jerusalem. The light that shines the farthest shines the brightest at home. If we're strong here locally, then we can be strong in the future. And listen, we're already pretty strong in world missions right now. But in the future, we can be so powerful and massive, influence the worldwide. Do you understand? So I don't feel funny about talking to you about money, and we're going to give a financial report, and I don't feel funny about talking about money, because I want to see people's lives change. That's why we're getting buildings. Listen, you don't see stained glass window hanging everywhere. I'm not going to do that. We're going to have a functional facility and put the money where it really needs to be in winning the lost for Jesus. Can I hear an amen? Can I hear an amen? So I want you to stand in a moment. Just stay seated for a moment. But I want you to stand, and I want you to think about this, and we're going to pray. Right now, the Harvest Ministry is here, and I want to get these cards to you first. You that are not members, you're visiting the church tonight, or it's your first time with us, simply put your hand up right now. These gentlemen are going to give you a card. Fill it out. Leave it in the offering, or place it at the information center. How many like my shirt? Pretty, isn't it? I should wear these a lot. They're very comfortable. If you didn't know, this is African. How many knew this was African? Oh, I didn't think you knew. Let's stand to our feet and let's give some money to the Lord and to His work, and let's do it with cheerfulness and joy. And let's give a lot. I pray that I'll have me 50 millionaires giving me $1 million each. If you do, we'll pay this thing off. We'll give millions of dollars to world missions, change the world that we live in. I can't wait to take whole tours to certain countries that we're in so you could smell what I smelled, see what I saw, and feel what I felt. Let's lift our hands to the Lord and let's pray right now. Say, Jesus, I know there's a way of giving and always being able to receive. I sow to reap. Lord, I know if I water, You will water me. Lord, help me be a part of expanding Your kingdom by giving, Lord, of monies that we may be sowed into Your kingdom. Speak to me now and I'll obey You. Because I love You. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Ushers, come and pass out the envelopes to everyone. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. I heard my wife did good. I want to say how much I appreciate my pastoral team, Pastor Mason, and all the pastoral team. Did Walt Beadle do good last Wednesday night? How many heard Walt? I heard glory reports. I didn't get to call very much from Kenya. And the reason is it was $11 a minute to call. It's a long ways over there, folks. And Kay says, thank God he didn't call much. It was expensive to call. So I just say, I'm here, I'm safe, goodbye. But I heard about the great things that happened while my absence, and I appreciate my little wife. She's kind of wore out now. I didn't do this on purpose, but I just thought I'd let her. Hallelujah. But she said, honey, I sure am glad to see you. I thought it was because she wanted to kiss me, but she's just glad that I was home. That was wonderful. Julie, come and minister to us right now in song.
As I door, I sensed His presence, and I knew this was the place where love abounds. For this is the temple, Jehovah. On holy ground. and at his feet peace of mind can still be found.
Thank you, darling. Will the ushers come and receive the offering now? Hallelujah. If you don't mind, gentlemen, we'll receive this offering. Sign up at the information desk to attend the North Church International Worship Conference, June the 1st through the 3rd. Cost for the people of our church is only $10. You'll be receiving some good information. March for Jesus meeting immediately after the service in the powerhouse tonight. All right? Amen. Tonight we're going to have Kay Leeper, our chief of staff, come for a while here. And she is going to share with you some information about the way our church is going on financially. I'm very proud of Kay. She does an excellent job. Jim Gwynn, an associate, a CPA firm that is the largest CPA firm that is managing Christian organizations. This is our firm. We have an outside audit with an inside audit, but an outside audit with them. And they compliment Kay Leeper and her team. Well, they tell us ours is by far the easiest they deal with, because the material is there when they come to look at our books and see if everything is in place. So I want you to give Kay a great big hand as she comes and presents.
Okay, you can turn the lights off. Okay, listen, first of all, I want to say what a privilege it is for me to be here, because, you know, I really consider this just an honor that Pastor and Coral have given me the opportunity to work for them. And also, I really appreciate me having the opportunity to work for you, because, you know, I do work for you. And that's one of the things that Pastor really stresses to the staff, is that we work for you. And every Sunday and every Wednesday before he leaves that green room, that's what he says, we're here for those people. And because you are very important. And because we're a family, tonight this is family business. We're talking about what's happening in our church. And one of the things I really want to stress is that Pastor has a saying, if you don't have a closet, you don't have to worry about anything being in the closet. And so one of the things that we do, we really go beyond every measure to make sure everything's done in decently in order. Because, you know, we're in a day and age where people really do not trust a lot of things. And so one of the things that we do, we have our CPA firm to come out on a quarterly basis. It doesn't cost us any more to have them come out quarterly as opposed to once a year. But what this does do is, in fact, in every 3 months, I know exactly what's happening. I make sure they tell me if we need to change anything, do anything. They look at all the pieces of paper and make sure everything's done right. Because how many of you want, because if anybody ever comes and says to you anything, you say, hey, look, I know what goes on in my church. It's not like we have one person in a room getting everything together and no one else knows what's happening. In fact, we are so open with our finances every Tuesday morning in staff. We have all of our staff come into our staff room, and Pastor Kennedy has a list of what we have to have that week and what came in the offering. And we have our staff praying over it. So we are very, very open about finances. So first of all, I'm going to pray, and then we're going to start, okay? Lord Jesus, I just thank you for this time. And Lord, I ask that every word I say will give glory to you, and that people will understand and clearly see what we're trying to accomplish in our vision. Lord, I ask this in your precious name. Amen. Okay, the first chart that I want to show you is a comparison of what we have done from day one of our church. And this is from 1990 up to present, 1994. And as you will see, every year we have gained substantially. The only year that we didn't grow in a substantial way was 91 to 92. And if you recall, if you were here in 91, that's when we had that miracle year and all that extra finances come in that we had to have at the bank. That was the year all that extra income, like $500,000 extra came in so we could buy this building. But every year we have grown, and you can see how much we've grown over 93 from 94. It was like $2,607,601. You need to give yourself a hand. This is tremendous. But you know what? It really doesn't matter how much you take in. It's what you do with it. How many of you know that in your own household? So let's get about really the real serious business. Let's talk about how we spend your money, okay? This is, and how we've broke this up is we want to make it very clear. You know, I'm always very suspicious when someone comes to me and they try to show me something. They bring me a bunch of computer paper and they throw it on my desk. It's big stacks of it. And it tries to confuse me sometimes. You know what? I am a very plain person. I want to cut to the fat. I want to know what's going on. So tonight, I tried to make this as real simple so any of you that even manage your own household, this will be real clear for all of us. Okay, number one, I want you to look at the administration. Now, what this actually consists of is this is the facilities. This is the operation and maintenance of this building. This is the land payments, the building payments, the parking lots, the utilities, the equipment, maintenance, office supplies, printing, labor, outside services, repairs, professional fees, legals, and vehicle expense. Now, this is just an enormous amount of the actual operating of this building. Now, this does not include salaries. This is totally separate, but this is just the actual what it costs to keep this building going. Okay? Now, one of the things that's really exciting to me about this is when you look at, this is 41% of our total income. But what is really exciting to me is when you add up what this is, which is $950,000, I know some people who have churches that can't seat as many as we seat, and their building payment alone, okay, is anywhere from $95,000 to over $100-something thousand a month. Okay? So God has supernaturally helped us to do this. And another exciting thing is we go along, as Pastor Saul says, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. Every month, we consistently bite on this elephant. And like, just like, for instance, it was a big deal to us when we bought our new vans. Okay, we bought our three vans. We stepped out. We were so excited. And how many of us use them? Okay, the children can be dismissed. If the kids are still in here, they can leave for their classes. Okay, but guess what? Our three vans will be paid for in December of this year. So what that will enable us to do is we take that money and we will put on something else to start even taking bigger bites of the elephant. So this is what really is exciting to us, when we can see there are certain things that we're not going to have to do again. You know what I mean? And this is what is so exciting when you see what God is doing for us. And hey, we're a young church. We're a baby church. Okay, the next area that we are talking about is the area of ministry, is the every area as far as like women's ministry, care, Christian education, calling, career, harvest, men's ministry, music, nursery, Parents Day Out, Powerhouse Children, singles, Spanish ministry, special speakers, visiting ministry, young marrieds. This is any of the ministry area that was involved in our church. This is 12%, which is $293,117. This is an area where we really serve and really touch the needs of the people. This is a very vital area, and we're really excited about that. Now, a lot of people, this next area we're going to look at is salaries and wages. A lot of people will group that in with something else. But we are so proud of this area, we wanted to make it totally separate so you could see what it is. This is a $845,316, and this is 36%. But let me explain to you when I say this is 36%. A lot of businesses are outsourcing their labor. In other words, like they have their bookkeeping system to be outsourced, and so actually they put it in the operating expense so it's not shown, okay? And then you look at salaries and they say, oh, we got this much in salaries. But in reality, that's not total salaries. Because if you outsource something to someone else, that's really, in fact, not a real picture. This is everything. This is nursery workers. This is Parents Day Out. This is the policemen. This is contract people we have come in that we pay them to do certain things. And like, for instance, you know, these speakers. Have you noticed how neat it was when we put all these speakers up? Well, we in-house did the labor on these. And how many of you know it would have cost us tens of thousands of dollars just the labor to get them put up? But we in-house did that. So this is what I'm saying. We take care of all of our maintenance. This is all done in-house. And so we wanted you to know, I mean, this is like payroll taxes, any insurance that we, for any kind of employee benefits. So this is a total picture, because this is a very good thing. And what this equates to is $70,000 a month or $35,000 every 2 weeks. And I'm telling you, that is a low amount when you consider we write over 60 checks every pay period. 20 of them are 25 are full-time, and then the rest are part-time. But these are people that are taking care of your children. And I don't know if you guys have noticed, but have y'all noticed how many nurseries we have? And we have them for almost every project. I mean, because poor Janice and them, they're doing all they can to staff them, and now we got two on Sunday mornings. But this is really because, you know what, we really care. And if you really are a family and you care, then you look and see what your people need, and then you try to address it. And so that's what we are really striving for. Another thing that we're really excited about is that we belong to the National Church Staff Compensation Survey. What this is a National Association of Church Business Administration. All of our salaries are go by this. They have what section of the country, how large your church is, and what their function is. We go by this, and they have a high, a medium, and a low, okay? And a lot of our people are in, like, in medium, or sometimes, or sometimes even low, but no one is in high, okay? We really gauge this, because this is important, because you know what? We want to be accountable. And you know, and once someone gets here and you start looking, but once you have a standard of measurement that you can look at and you can guide and you can go by, there's no guessing. You look and say, okay, what is their job description? How much? All this. And it's there. And this includes every fringe benefit. You know how sometimes a lot of things are hidden? You'll go, well, salaries are so much, but then over here on the left hand, there might be just, you know, a lot of fringe benefits. We don't, we're being very, very open and frank with you. And like I say, that's why we wanted to put it so you can know. So if anybody comes up to you and say, well, you know, I just want to know about your church, you know, what the ministers make, and you know this, you can be real honest with them and frank and know what's happening. And I one of the things I really prayed about, this is a couple of years ago, I was really praying, and you know, I was, because of staff, we're trying to look and vacillate, and as you grow, you have to do certain things. And I know, and I even shared this with the staff, I know God did not call us just to be a big staff. All we are is just a big monster, and as the church grows, you just take more and more on, and you can't do more things, because no matter, it just doesn't matter what you take in, it's really what you spend. And so what we have a real desire for, and what Pastor and Coral's heart is, we want to do more. We want to give $1 million to missions. Well, if you just keep, the staff just keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger as you grow, you're not going to be that effective. So what we have really determined in our hearts, and we really prayed about it, we have gone to our staff and we said we want good staff. We don't want hirelings. We want people that are called, and this is a ministry to them, and they have a heart for it, and they care about it. And what we want to do is we want to equip them with the right equipment, like computers and stuff like this, that will enable them and empower them to do a lot more work, and we don't have to keep adding staff. Now, we will apparently have to add like certain pastors and secretaries as we go along. But our desire is, we're going into two services, we want to keep our expenses the same. And we continue to grow as we are, we will have more net income to do things that we really are called to do. I mean, God has a reason for us to be here, and we want to attain those goals that Pastor has shared with us, what we have. Another thing that's really exciting we're doing is we created a new department this year. And what we're doing is we have created a communications department. And what this does is this enables us to do all of our getting our graphics ready for printing and everything. We do all that in-house now. And just like on one brochure that we did as of lately, we saved like $1,600 on the labor and getting it ready. Because what we do now, we have got the computers, etc. We've got the staff in that department, and they are doing all of our graphics. We're not putting our graphics out at all. We're doing them all in-house. And the only thing that we're actually sending out now is the actual printing, but it's camera ready when it goes. And how many of you know that the real expense in printing is not the printing so much, though, it's getting it ready, the graphics, etc. Well, see, we're doing all of that in-house now, and that's part of the salary, you see. So, and we've got our television ministry, all of that is reflected in this salary part. So I'm saying we are being very open, and you can see how much we're accomplishing with a little amount. And I am really excited, and God has supernaturally brought us staff. We have never had as good a staff as we do now. I told Pastor, and I think probably 4 or 5 months ago, I told him, I said, for the first time, we are ready to go the next level with the staff we have. I mean, God has really bought us good staff. Like right now, the majority of the secretaries are in counting money right now. And the reason they are is because we went on to a new software system that's going to enable us to do a lot more, a lot faster. And we are in the process of training for it. So the lady's coming to train tomorrow. So because of that, they came to me and said, can we count the offering on Wednesday night so we can be in our training tomorrow? They came to me and asked me. You see what I'm talking about? We're talking about people who have a heart and who care about their church. Because you know what? That makes the difference. It's a heart issue. And we are so excited about that. Okay. The next area we want to go to is missions. This is 11% of our income. It's $180,841. Now, what this really is like mission / outreach. This is like Clothe a Child, Angel Tree, Africa, Mexico, Church on the Rock International, planning of local churches, benevolence. And what this means is like, for instance, we have... we had some churches that were being established in Florida. And so pastor agreed to send them a certain amount every month so they could get on their feet. Because, you know, when you're starting something, it's hard when you have no income whatsoever. So this is what this includes. And then this also includes anything we do for our home missions, like the bus that we have every week. Okay, and this is also the homeless, and then this is also the money for Reaching Hands that we use for the administration of that. But it is so neat when I know what God's going to do and what He has done. And I was really praying about this because honestly, this is the truth. This is not my thing, okay? I'm much better in a support role in the back. And, you know, how good is it to have Pastor back, you guys? I mean, was that, you know, it's like when Daddy's home, it's just, not that anything is really that much different, but just when the covering's there, it's just different. I mean, and he only missed one Sunday and one Wednesday night, but it seems like he'd been gone so long. I mean, it's so good to have him back. And I know poor Coral, bless her heart. I mean, I know she is. But you know, as I was praying and meditating, this scripture really came to me. And I think this is sums up what I really feel like God is saying to us. I want you to look in your Bible in Genesis 11:1. Yes, you can turn the lights on. And I want you to really have ears to what God is saying here, because I think this is a real statement that God is really telling us and pointing us to a direction. Okay, this is Genesis 11:1. Now the whole earth had one language and one speech. And it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. Then they said one to another, "Come, let us make bricks and bake them thoroughly." They had brick for stone, and they had asphalt for mortar. And they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city, and a tower whose top is in the heavens. Let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad over the face of the whole earth." But the Lord, I want y'all to all repeat after me, "But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the sons of the men had built. And the Lord said, indeed the people are one, and they have all but one, they have all one language, and this is what they began to do. Now nothing that they propose to do will be withheld from them. Come, let us go down and there confuse their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from there over the face of all the earth, and they ceased building the city. Therefore the name is called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth, and from there the Lord scattered them abroad over the face of all the earth." You know, what really strikes me and what I really believe God was showing me is if people become one, if we really get focused, the Lord said they could build this into the heavens, and this was without God. If we as a people at the North Church, if we unite as one, if we get totally focused on what God has told Pastor that we are to accomplish, if we get focused, there is nothing with God's help that we cannot accomplish. I'm talking, we desperately need some things, okay? This year, we have been so blessed. We were giving a board, a soundboard that we were going to have to buy. We're talking $40,000 to $50,000. It was given to us. I mean, God supernaturally has blessed us. Okay? Now, I just got to get a room around it. I need a sound room, okay? I need that. That's not something I wish. That's something we need to get. We need lights out in these parking lots. These are critical things. We, you know, Coral, bless her heart, I was talking to her about some things that we have got some wallpaper and we're needing to get done. And I told her, I said, I was going to surprise you and we're going to get it done this week. It was a very minimum thing, but she's so thrilled. You know what she said to me? She said, Kay, that means more to me, she said, than any Mother's Day gift I could get. She cares more about just getting a little bit of trim put up because that's where her heart is. This is where her heart is. And she cares. I mean, she's down here spray painting this stuff. I mean, she's not one that sits in the ivory tower and says, I don't care, just get it done. I mean, she's down here working on the flowers, getting everything done. I mean, you should see how hard she's working on this show we do on Saturday night. You know, I thought that show would be easier, okay? I had no idea how much harder it's going to be. But it is so powerful, and we're seeing so many lives change. I mean, on a weekly basis, if really, everyone here should commit to go at least once and man those phones on Saturday night. I promise you, you will be a changed person when you leave. Because you know what? The first night I did it, I called Gary, and on my way home, I said, honey, we don't have a problem. We don't have a problem. We get so thinking about this, and then when you hear some of these tragic stories that are so, I mean, every one of them, your heart breaks. I'm telling you, people are getting changed. Their lives are being changed. And you know what? We have no idea how many people that we are touching in a real capacity that's going to go and touch. Just like Pastor, when he prayed for that man and gave him that lapel, a pin. We're talking 720 churches now in Africa. Pastor didn't know that. You know what? God's a good bookkeeper. Amen. God is a good bookkeeper. That man that gave Pastor that tract when he's at Lee Park, okay? God's a good bookkeeper, guys, okay? And I'm telling you right now, every one of us, this is our television show on Saturday night. This church is actually paying for it. So guess what? God's a good bookkeeper. He sees we're touching people's lives and their needs. And I'm telling you what, if you don't give, we don't do. Now, that is really true, because you know what? If you people, your faithfulness, and I'm telling you, we are so thrilled what you're doing. You respond, it's just incredible. We have got the best church. I mean, really, even when Pastor and Coral are not here and you're not even anywhere around, you should hear them brag on you about what a wonderful church you are, how you care. There's just, this year, our Saab ministry, I mean, how many have liked the bookstore? That was done all in-house. I mean, there are so many projects. If we had to pay for all, the care leaders and the touch pastors and all of these things that gets done, I mean, this harvest ministry, if we had to pay for that, there's no way we could do it. But everybody doing their part is making such a difference. But tonight, I just really want you to really determine in your heart and really get focused, get behind the vision. And I mean really, because I'm telling you, there is nothing we can accomplish if we stand together in one. Amen. That's it.
Amen. Thank you, Kay. Thank you. She's all business, folks, I'm telling you. She's got it. She said, I'm through and that's it. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, what is really exciting is I believe it said 2.6 million. We're increasing every year. Let me explain to you something that's going to be wonderful. When we can double in our services, we can double in our income. When we double in our income, we can actually double up on our payments. And instead of 4 years we owe on these payments, we can terminate these payments quicker as we grow. We get debt-free around here. Do you understand what we can be doing in outreaches in the inner city and all over this metroplex into our country of Mexico? We're in Belize now. We have 6 works just came to my attention in Belize, and that's down near Central America. We're going all the way down to South America. We're in Africa, extremely strong far beyond my. And so we're going to be doing things that is absolutely amazing for a church that's less than 10 years old. We're not but 6 years old. By the time we reach our 10th anniversary, we're going to be debt free. I'm believing God for, we're going to have around here about $12 million worth of property paid for and equipment. And we stand and we're able to give $1 million a year to world missions, home missions, and world missions. Let me tell you something. That's a neat thing. Not giving it to the bank in interest payments, but giving it to help world evangelism to change our world for Jesus Christ. I really believe in this mission we're on. How many of you believe in it? I know you do. So I'm setting a goal. Would I be ridiculous to say in 95 we should do 3 million two? 3 million three? 3 million three. From 2.6 to 3 million three should be our goal for 95. Okay? And the way you do this, folks, we just keep growing every year and we'll get to 5 million a year, 6 million a year. We're going to be debt free when we get to those type of numbers. And you say, well, Pastor, we won't have need for the money. Oh, yes, we will. We'll change Africa. We'll change Mexico. We'll do some serious things for the kingdom of God. You understand? Feeding people with 50 tons of food, we'll do that. Clothes are coming in here soon. We got a truckload of clothes coming in to clothe the homeless. We gave 50, what is it? What is it now? How many pounds is it? 763,000 pounds of food we've given away since the first of this year. Did you hear me? 763,000 pounds. And now we're starting into clothes. We have our first truckload of clothes coming in. Supposed to be in the next few weeks. Dick Babin always telling me it's supposed to come in a couple weeks after we're back from Africa. So I didn't know if it was coming, if you got the notice. Not yet. But our first load of clothes is coming in thanks to J.C. Penney. Amen. These are not used clothes. These are brand new clothes for this people. So you not only are the people on the streets getting bananas, we had two truckloads or so of truckloads of bananas. I said, every homeless person in Dallas has got one of our bananas. Tons of bananas. You understand? I'm so excited about this. North Dallas Church, get really successful, get really rich, bluntly, get really prosperous church. Everybody here, go out there and make all the money you can make. Get prosperous, get wealthy, bluntly. And let's sow seeds and let's really do something. Not just building something to say, look at the great building I built for my monument. Every time, remember when we was over on 35 U that were there? I said, I think I'll always keep warehouses. The look of a warehouse, you remember that? Least we begin to worship the building and forget what we're called to actually do. Is win the lost, clothe the naked, feed the hungry, and reach the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Somebody say amen. Amen. I want you to turn in your Bibles to Peter. Being up all 24 hours, you guys, you got to understand, I get a little mixed up there. In the epistle of Peter, 2 Peter, the first chapter. Listen what it says here in the first verse of 2 Peter. Now what is happening in this passage, this book, is Peter is exhorting people about deceivers that would come. He is exposing them to the last day, that there will be many deceivers and that will bring people into false ideas. And so he is exhorting the believers to live according to the biblical standards that he has presented to them in his writings and all the Holy Scripture. But the first verse it says this, to those who have obtained like precious faith with us by righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of our Jesus our Lord, as his divine power has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness, through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, and by which have been given to us exceeding and great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, and escape the corruption that is in the world through lust. Now what he's saying to us is that we all have a common faith. That every one of us that know Jesus has come to know him the exact same way as our personal Lord and Savior. It's by faith. Every person in this room that has experienced reconciliation, they've been reconciled, have come the same exact way. We were born sinners. We are saved by grace. And that grace has been extended to all of us. We all have this grace, and it's come to us as believers. Now, we're beginning to dig into the depths of all that we've inherited. And we can be partakers of that divine nature or that inheritance by living according to truth. The way we become partakers is these precious promises that we read in the Bible. And if we believe on these precious promises, act on them in faith, something begins to happen in our very nature. We begin to draw out of God's resources life and the ability to live a superior life in a very dark and cruel world. But God wants all of us to begin to live by these principles that we find in the Bible, that we live by the Word of God, and we begin to grow and take responsibility as mature citizens in the kingdom of God. You know, when I got married, I took on responsibility. But with responsibility, it gave me authority. You do not have authority unless you assume responsibility. If you assume the responsibility for something, ultimately you'll have the authority. A lot of people want the authority without the responsibility. It doesn't happen. But if you take responsibility for something, immediately the authority will come to you. It's like a magnet that's pulling something to it. When you assume responsibility, you begin to have authority in life. If you assume responsibility for a marriage, you begin to have authority in that relationship. You assume responsibility for children, you begin to have authority to minister to those children. That is in life. If you take responsibility for a job, you will begin to have the authority ultimately to carry out that job. Because God wants you to understand that we have a responsibility to take these precious promises, and that we become mature in the faith, we grow in the faith, and we understand that the kingdom of God is our responsibility. It's not somebody else's responsibility, it's my responsibility. That's why I sow, that's why I give money, that's why I pray, that's why I'm faithful to church, that's why I witness. It is my responsibility. If I take the responsibility serious, God will grant me the authority to carry out that responsibility. Do you understand? But a lot of people don't take the responsibility. They don't tithe. Well, God doesn't give them authority in their financial areas. They don't take responsibility in the area of the kingdom of God. They don't witness, so they never experience the authority because they've not taken the responsibility to lead the lost to Christ. They don't pray, so they don't have authority in their prayer life. If you take the responsibility, God will grant you more authority to be able to handle the responsibility that you have assumed under him. Now, we have a vast responsibility when it comes to this scripture, because he has given his all that you and I might be saved. We are debtors to him. I don't have to be embarrassed or nervous about talking about finances. How many of you think that, can you put a number, a dollar figure? If you could put a dollar figure on how much eternal life would be worth, what would it be worth? $500? $1,000? I mean, you'll never die, never go to hell. Can you put a dollar number on it? Can you put a dollar number on how precious it is, how wonderful it is? Well, it's worth $1 million. It's worth $1 million? You mean if you had $1 million, you'd pay $1 million to make sure you didn't go to hell? Really? Can you put a dollar and cent number on it? No way. It's priceless. You could never pay enough money. That's why God sent his only son to die for you. Because you'll never have enough to be able to pay for eternal life. Only God could pay the payment in full. But we have a responsibility now. You are not your own. You've been bought with a price. The precious blood of Jesus Christ. You are his. You belong to him. I belong to him. So we must take responsibility. Yes, as Acts says, for Jerusalem, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. I must take responsibility for those that I don't even know, that I've never met. I must take responsibility that they must hear, and they must hear the gospel message. They're not my relatives. They're not my friends. They're in other places. They speak different languages. I must take responsibility for them because I'm a debtor. Because Jesus loved them and loves them just as much as he loves me right now and loves you. We have got a responsibility. And that's what happens when we start talking about finances. We start bringing our tithes and our offerings. And we're saying, I'm going to be faithful to my responsibility in the kingdom of God. God says, I'm going to give you authority over financial situations. Because you have taken responsibility. And God has said, I'll give you authority over in financial areas. Because you've taken responsibility in areas that are very important to me. I'm not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. When you take responsibility and not wanting any to die and go to hell, God will give you necessary authority to begin to be a sower and a reaper and continue to be blessed and prosperous in life because you've seized responsibility. It's very important for us to understand this, but we got to move on in maturity because if we're really growing in this divine nature, we're going to begin to understand that the heartbeat of our Lord. Let me tell you something. I'm just going to be graphic for a moment. I went to little churches in industrial areas of Nairobi. Drove down these little dirt roads. You could feel the smell of the chemicals as they were poured out on the ground. There was no environmentalist there. And little babies were running around everywhere. Some of them naked. Some of them in their little dirty underwear. Little babies. They come running, grabbing my hand, living in that environment. I had to go to the restroom, so I went to the public restroom. What it was a plastic wall built up with some stakes on each end, and human waste was all in there. That was their normal environment. I said, oh God, give me 10,000 people so I can make a little bit of difference in this world. Give me 10,000. That's what I cried standing. I'm saying it. And that human waste all around me, holding my breath, said, God, give me 10,000 people in North Dallas so I can make a little difference in this crazy world. I went out there and all the little kids, everywhere I went, I take more pictures of kids than anything else, and they were all gathering, hugging on me, and I'm holding their hands. They said there's diseases there that they don't even have names for. Didn't really care. Just rip your heart right out of your body. People that Jesus loves as much as he loves you and me. And I cried to God, God, give us the most successful church. Give me a church of 10,000. And get it paid off, Lord, so we can make a little difference. Remember the little boy that we brought from Chiapas, state of Mexico, and he had this clap palate? We flew him up here and we paid his way. Our church did. It wasn't me. It's our church. When that happens, you all just sit smile because you paid for it. Do you understand? I flew him up here. We took him down in Louisiana and got his surgery on his little cleft palate. They took a rib out of his little side and built him a roof of the mouth. He had never been able to have that happen to him. He would have lived there with that deformity the rest of his life. Now I got a picture of him. He's got pretty little lips. got a clipped palate. No more. Why do we want a big church? We got them in Jerusalem, Samaria, the uttermost parts of the earth. See, a lot of people always dream about the uttermost parts of the earth, but they never lay a foundation solid enough to make sure it continues. You got to count the cost before you run the race. We're getting in a position in the next few years, church, that we can make a significant difference in this world. A significant difference in this world. But we got to draw on this divine nature. We got to say, Lord, fill me full of it. Let me be a partaker. Let me know prosperity, yes, but just pass the gravy. We can do so much more together than we could ever do apart. Both locally and nationally and internationally. I really have a heart for this. And I've always had a heart for this. I just understand something. A lot of people get way out beyond because they're not. I'm just telling you like it is. I have met more people, more ministers that people thought were genius. And I had to look at them and say, well, that don't look like a genius to me. How foolish they've been. It don't look like a brainy guy to me. Build a boat with holes in it isn't smart. You understand? Plug up the holes so you can stay afloat. We have a responsibility. And it's wonderful. It's exciting. We're going to establish a Bible college. I forget the name of the town. It's between Molo and Nairobi. It's a city of about 300,000 to 400,000. We're going to establish a Bible college in the next 2 years. I've committed myself to it there in Africa, our Bible college, like we did in Mexico. We got a young doctor. I met him, young African man, young doctor. We're going to build us a clinic someday over there. So those little kids in those little ghettos, they can get those infections. They had open sores and boils all over their little bodies. One man they brought for prayer, they got him off his sick bed. He died 2 days after I left this one place. Came in, he was a skeleton. It was cancer of the liver. All they did was give him vitamins. They had no other treatment available. We are blessed. But I said, God, bless us more. Make everybody in this church, God do it, wealthy. But God, let them be responsible with that wealth. Don't let them just get wealthy to take themselves some things and do some things for themselves and become more selfish. Let them get wealthy and let us do something together. I mean this. I want you to be happy, prosperous, blessed, loaded with money.